Welcome to Engineering Python. This is a Python programming course for engineers. In this video, I will talk about how to use MatPlotLib to create high-quality 2D and 3D images from data. Python has many data plotting and visualization packages. The most famous ones are MatPlotLib, Seaborn, Bokeh, and Plotly. A comparison of these packages can be found by following this link. In this video, we'll only talk about MatPlotLib. Before we start plotting in Jupyter Notebook, we need to activate the notebook renderer using this magic. %MatPlotLib notebook. All the plots will be shown in this web browser, and we can interact with the output figures. Next, we'll import the pyplot submodule as plt from MatPlotLib. After all these preparations, let's create our first figure. We will create a figure object named fig using plt.figure function. This is figure 1. The size is specified in fig size. This tuple means we are creating a figure of 5 inches by 4 inches. DPI is short for dots per inch. It determines the resolution of the figure. The greater this number, the more details it includes. And also the larger the image size. I just give it value 80. Next, we plot the data points stored in a list using plt.plot. These are the y values. Because we didn't specify the x values, by default, they will be the indexes of the numbers in the list. So x values are actually 0, 1, 2, and 3. So this statement plots 4 data points in the 2D space. 0, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, and 3, 4. These data points are connected using solid lines by default. After that, we set x labels and y labels. There are x values and y values, respectively. After the plotting is done, the image is created in the memory. We need to use the last statement, plt.show, to display it on the computer screen, so we can actually see this figure. A common mistake is forgetting to show the image at the end. We can use these buttons to interact with this figure. The first button is resetting to the original view. The second button is going back to the previous view. The third button is forwarding to next view. The fourth button is panning or moving the image. Click this button and you can drag the image. Reset it to the original view. The fifth button is zooming. Click this button and you can select the region to zoom. Reset it to the original view. The last button is downloading and saving the figure. Now let's see the second example. We will use NumPy. So we import NumPy as np. We already talked about how to use NumPy in some previous videos in this course. Next, we create a NumPy array x using the linspace function. There are a total of 7 data points. They are evenly distributed between negative pi and positive pi. Then we create another array c that stores the cosine values of all the elements in x. The other array s that stores the sine values of all the elements in x. After that, we create a new 5-inch by 4-inch figure. The DPI is 80. We plot x, c. That means the horizontal x information comes from x, and the vertical x information comes from c. This curve is drawn in blue lines. We have a total of 7 points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. We plot xs, that means the horizontal axis information comes from x, and vertical axis information comes from y. This curve is drawn in orange lines. We have a total of 7 points, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. The final step is to show the figure in the memory to the computer screen. This is figure 2. In this figure, because we only have 7 data points for each curve, we can still see the line segments very clearly. In the next example, we create 256 points between negative pi and positive pi. Then we follow the same procedure and plot these two curves in figure 3. We no longer see the line segments anymore. These two curves are still composed of line segments, but because the distance between any two data points is so small, we have an illusion that these are two smooth curves. If we zoom in multiple times, we can still see the line segments. Now we are done with plotting with default settings. We want to make changes to the plots based on our own preferences. In this example, I'll show you how to set the line color, the line widths, and the line style. In the code, the only differences are in the plot statement. We explicitly set the color of the cosine curve to navy, which is a color string. Set the line width to 2, which is thicker than the default width. Set the line style to 2 dashes, which means a dashed line. For the sine curve, we set the color to deep pink. The line width is 1. The line style is a single dash, which means a solid line. The result is shown in figure 4. Now we will set the x-axis and y-axis limits and ticks. The difference between this program and the previous one lies in lines 4 through 7. In line 4, we set x limits to be negative 4 and positive 4. So this is negative 4 and this is positive 4. In line 5, we set y's limits to be negative 1 and positive 1. So this is negative 1 and this is positive 1. That means we only care about this small region. We don't care about the information outside of this region. In line 6, we set a total of 9 ticks for the x-axis, evenly distributed between negative 4 and positive 4. In figure 5, these ticks are negative 4, negative 3, negative 2, and so on. In line 7, we set a total of 5 ticks for the y-axis, evenly distributed between negative 1 and positive 1. In figure 5, these ticks are negative 1, negative 0.5, 0, and so on. Next, we want to change the ticks to represent some interesting values. In line 6, we set x ticks to these interesting points, negative pi, negative a half pi, 0, positive a half pi, and positive pi. In line 7, we set y ticks to these interesting points, negative 1, 0, and positive 1. The result is shown in figure 6. We could guess that 3.142 is pi, but it would be better to make it explicit using the Greek letter pi. To do that, we need to customize tick labels with LaTeX expressions. In lines 6 and 7, in addition to this list of interesting points, we need to define a list of raw strings. A raw string starts with a lowercase letter r followed by a pair of quotation marks. Inside the quotation marks, we have a pair of dollar signs. They mark the start and end of the LaTeX mass tags. Between the dollar signs, we have a negative sign, then backslash pi. The backslash pi is LaTeX code for Greek letter pi. For the next point, it's negative backslash pi over 2. Again, backslash pi will be replaced by the Greek letter pi. The next several raw strings can be explained in the same way. For y ticks, we do the same. Take a look at the final result in figure 7. These x ticks are replaced by Greek letters. Y ticks are replaced by negative 1, 0, and positive 1. Now this positive sign is showing explicitly. Next, we will try to move the figure spines, which are the borders, to different locations. The new code is located in lines 10 through 14. In line 10, we use the GCA function to get the current axis. Then we set the color of the right spine to none. It means we make the right border disappear. We do the same to the top spine. So the top border will disappear as well. Now we set the position of the bottom spine to the new position, where the y value is equal to 0. It means we move the bottom border up to the center. In line 14, we set the position of the left spine to the new position where the x value is equal to 0. It means we move the left border right to the middle. The result is shown in figure 8. This figure looks pretty good, but we are not satisfied with this result yet. Next, we will add a legend to mark which curve is the sine function and which one is the cosine function. The changes are in lines 2, 3, and 4 in this program. In line 2, we specify an additional parameter, label equals cosine, because this is a cosine function. In line 3, we specify an additional parameter, label equals sine, because this is a sine function. In line 4, we add a legend using the legend function. We put the legend in the upper left corner so it doesn't overlap with other parts of the figure. The result is in figure 9. In the next example, we're interested in the point x sine x in the coordinate system when x is equal to 2 pi over 3. We want to create an arrow pointing to this point and show its value. Sine 2 pi over 3 equals the square root of 3 over 2. The code is in lines 17 through 23. In line 17, we define the x value. It's 2 pi over 3. Then in line 18, we plot a red dotted line between two points, x0 and x sine x. The line width is 2. After that, we put a red scatter dot with size 20 to mark the point x sine x. Finally, we add some text using the annotation function like sine 2 pi over 3 equals the square root of 3 over 2. We put this text in this location. The coordinate system of this point is the data's coordinate system. The text will be offset to the right by 10 points, and offset to the top by 30 points. The font size is 16. We use an arrow to connect the text and the point. This arrow is actually an arc with a radius 0.2. This is very complex syntax. The result is shown in figure 10. Next, we will make the text labels bigger and transparent. The code is located in lines 25 through 27. There are many text labels. ax.getxlabels will return all the x text labels. And ax.getytextlabels will return all the y text labels. We put them together and use a for loop to deal with them all. For each label, we set the font size to 16. Then we set the background box of each label to green. The alpha value, or transparency, is 10%. No edge color. The result is in figure 11. In the last example, we change the size and save the figure locally on the computer. In the first line, the figure size is changed to 8 by 4 inches. In line 29, we use a savefig function to save this figure 12 on the computer as the sine cosine .png file. The DPI is 300, which is the publication quality. Okay, that was a brief overview of MatPlotLib. The course materials are available on YouTube and GitHub. You can watch the course videos in sequence. If you like this video, please subscribe and share. I'm Yong Wang. Thanks for watching.